Survivors and Losses. Glenn Belcher was soon located by his father. By that time, Mr. Belcher was carefully looking over the bodies that were being lined up by the school fence. Dead students were being transported to the various morgues in the area. After having found his dead wife and learning that his son, Tommy, was safe in the hospital, Mr. Belcher was almost devoid of hope for finding Glenn alive. Their reunion was indescribably emotional. Emergency workers on the scene were at their wits' end, trying to identify the bodies of the deceased. Knowing that Glenn had just been rescued from the rubble, where bodies were being removed one after another, the head of the Texas National Guard medical team approached Glenn and his father. "Sir, pardon me, Mr. Belcher. My name is Colonel Walter Pyron, with the 112th Cavalry Medical Detachment of the Texas National Guard out of Mineral Wells. Understanding that I have no direct authority in this matter, I would be honored if your boy could assist us in identifying some of the students we have uncovered. We've got parents lined up all around the school, trying to identify their children." "I'm not sure we're up for that, Colonel. Glenn here took quite a blow to his head and was knocked out for some time," said Mr. Belcher. "We lost his mother and need to go find his baby brother, who is in one of the hospitals." "I understand, sir, if I can be of any further assistance." Glenn interrupted the colonel. "I want to help out if I can, Pa." "I don't know, son. Are you sure you feel up to it?" "Yes, Pa. I haven't seen any of my friends. I'm worried about them. I don't know what happened when I was out, but I'm going to be okay. We can go see Tommy when we're done here. He'll be taken good care of in the hospital until we get there. Please let me help if I can," begged Glenn. Glenn's father told the colonel that they would try to help, but if the task became too difficult, he would have to take Glenn away. The colonel agreed and asked both to follow him. Colonel Pyron was soon lifting the sheets that had been placed over the faces of the victims that were being lined up beside the fence. Glenn recognized nearly all of the children, but could not provide the names for most. For others, he knew only their first name or nickname. Nevertheless, the colonel made a note on his clipboard each time Glenn gave him any information. Many of the bodies were marred beyond recognition. He identified Ollie from the corduroy jacket he wore every day, and thought the boy next to him might be his friend, Billy, but he was unsure. "Colonel Walter," asked Glenn, "would you mind looking in his back pocket? If this is Billy, you should find his cap rolled up there." Colonel Pyron searched the dead boy's pockets to find what Glenn had feared. Glenn continued down the line of sheeted corpses and soon recognized Mary's beautiful face with her auburn hair. Glenn soon became somewhat overwhelmed, and his daddy became concerned. "Son, you don't have to keep doing this. These kids are all with God now. There's no need for you to continue. We both had more than our share of upset today," said Glenn's father. "I need to find Latane if I can, Daddy. Please let me keep helping the colonel for a while longer." Mr. Belcher acquiesced to his son's insistence, but told Colonel Pyron he didn't think they could continue much longer. The colonel said he understood, but that Glenn was providing some very much needed information for the children's families. Glenn soon identified his classmates, Kenneth and Helen, along with four others from Mrs. Wright's class. At some point, the task of seeing more and more of his friends and classmates must have become more than Glenn could take. He began to hyperventilate and started running ahead of Colonel Pyron and his father, moving from one body to another, pulling sheets off the faces of each victim, laying it back down, and moving to the next one as fast as he could. His father yelled for Glenn to stop. Glenn froze in place, staring at the next body he was about to unveil.
"Tell me what's going on, Glenn," demanded his father.
"I need to find Latane, Daddy. I can't find her anywhere." Colonel Pyron asked Glenn, "Can you describe her to me, Glenn?"
Yes, sir, she was at my house last night, and we were at school all day. I rode with her daddy this morning, and she helped him drive through the lease. She's about an inch shorter than me, with light blue eyes, and has long hair that turns blonde in the sun. She was wearing a pink dress with a white collar the last time I saw her, and wears a gold ring with a gold rose on it.
Colonel Pyron looked at the ground to collect his thoughts before breaking the news to young Glenn.
I'm so sorry, Glenn. Latane's daddy identified her just after they freed you from the rubble. I hate to be the one to tell you this, but she's gone.
Glenn's heart sank. He hung his head and began to weep as his father wrapped a gentle arm around his shoulders. Colonel Pyron told Mr. Belcher,
"It's time to take your boy away from this place, Mr. Belcher. Thank you both for your assistance. I know this has been difficult. I will make a note of your son's admirable service." He turned to Glenn and said,
"Thank you, sir. You should be proud, Glenn Belcher."
The colonel reached out to shake Glenn's hand. Glenn could not immediately look up at him, but nevertheless extended his hand. The colonel remained standing at attention until the boy finally looked him in the eyes. When he finally did, Colonel Walter B. Pyron saluted the young man, turned in military fashion, and proceeded back to his medical team to pass along the information he had obtained.
Glenn matured quickly that night, sooner than most. The nightmares of this day would haunt him for years to come, but the fonder memories of his mother, the friends that he had lost forever, and his first love would provide him the inner strength he needed to carry on.
Glenn's friend and summertime co-worker, Joe Bo Kersey, was now safe at his home, having run 3 miles from the school to escape the devastation and commotion he had witnessed. He had a brother and an older sister who were also at the school. Both barely escaped with their lives. Jobo had helped his English teacher, a member of his church, escape through a narrow opening from the demolished caved-in classroom where they were when the school exploded. He had seen his classmate, Billy Hall, with a big gash on the side of his face. Another one of Jobo's classmates who survived was less fortunate. Years later, Jobo would eventually tell his story by saying, "My little playmate, Johnny Duke, had his head popped open, and to this day he's walking around with a steel plate in his head." Vera's family had once lived directly behind Johnny Duke. Vera and Johnny's sister Opal were best of friends for several years. Jobo's stepfather, a welder for Humble Oil and former president of the London School Board, was returning home from work when the school blew up. Jobo described what his father had done. "He was coming from the fields, and it happened just when he was coming by the school," said Jobo. "He was driving one of those Humble welding trucks, tore a school fence right down, and started to work." Jobo was not exactly sure how long his father helped at the scene, but believed he remained there for 24 hours. Like many survivors and rescuers in years to come, the father rarely spoke about his experience. Jobo said, "For a long time he was very tight-lipped on stuff like that." Years later, Jobo would still be removing tiny bits of concrete from his skull, but he avoided any future discussion or reminiscences. He described how he coped with his trauma following the tragedy. "No words can describe or illustrate what happened there. I don't want to think about the past. It's done, and it's over with. I prefer to think about the glorified days ahead." Before the explosion, H.G. White had just returned to his desk after asking his fifth grade math teacher, Miss Lena Hunt, to assist him with a problem. Then he began working on his multiplication tables. "I looked out the south window and something caught my eye. It just felt like somebody slapped me upside the head," recalled White. 5 boys and 3 girls survived out of the 32 students in his classroom. He was one of those boys. His teacher, Miss Hunt, was also killed. Another teacher found him while searching for survivors in the rubble. "The plaster was about an inch thick. It covered me up," H.G. said. "When she stepped,
She fell into me and saw I was alive. She reached down and pulled me up. I wasn't knocked out, so I can remember every squeak. Although he sustained head injuries in the blast, H.G. felt blessed to be alive. He later stated in an interview, "I should pay some debt to somebody because I was fortunate, real fortunate, to walk away." Approximately 500 students and 40 teachers were at the school at the time of the explosion. Only 130 of those would escape without serious injury. Most, but not all, of the additional parents and preschool children were protected inside the gym. The earliest death tolls were underestimated. They included 120 boys, 156 girls, 4 male teachers, and 12 female teachers. The remains of some were never recovered. 6 more dead were accounted for in the days that followed. Of the 112 critically injured victims, 13 would die shortly thereafter. Extended hospital stays would be necessary for at least 39 students. Rescuers continued working throughout the night in the rain and mud. Around 2,000 tons of debris were picked up and hauled away. Concrete slabs were broken up. Tangled steel was cut with torches. Smaller fragments of rubble that had to be shoveled were carried off in small baskets and carefully emptied under the floodlights to avoid overlooking a hand or foot or any torn portion of a body. Buildings in the neighboring communities of Henderson, Overton, Kilgore, and as far away as Tyler and Longview were converted into makeshift morgues to house the enormous number of bodies. Everything from family cars to delivery trucks served as hearses and ambulances. Frantic parents continued searching, viewing torn and mangled corpses to try and identify their missing children. When daylight arrived, 17 hours following the explosion, the entire site had been leveled. However, work in the area and official investigations at the disaster site continued for days. For the parents, who had to bury their children and carry on with their lives, the days that followed were no less heart-wrenching. The poem that follows was written by one of the youngest survivors of this tragedy and chillingly expresses what so many who were devastated experienced and were feeling on that night and the following day. Cold Morning, 1937. The night of the disaster, no one slept. Sirens ripped the darkness with doom. Dogs howled back. After the bodies were found, we tried sleep, staring at the ceiling, fixed by memories we could never escape or soon describe. Exhaustion loosened our grip on consciousness. We slipped into a dark pool, lay floating face down below the surface until the gray pool merged with gray dawn. We rose, forcing our leaden feet to the terrible task. Caskets, the unctuous minister, the exhausted emergency worker. In a garage beside the mortuary, makeshift tables held the remnants of lives shrouded in bloody sheets. Rituals were omitted. No neighbors stood in doorways bearing plates of cake. Those not bereaved avoided our eyes, terrible as gorgons. Yesterday's March morning warmed to the trills of mockingbirds. Gulf breezes rushing inland tossed new bluebonnets. Today is a cottonmouth under a cold stone. Carolyn Jones Frye.